In this video, we are going to discuss why the concept of shoulder impingement should be abandoned by clinicians.
Enroll in our online course now. Link is in the video description.
Hi and welcome back to Physiotutors. In the 1970s and 80s, Near coined the term subacromial impingement syndrome. Following his theory, he claimed that impingement occurs on the tendinous portion of the rotator cuff by the coracoacromial ligament and the anterior third of the acromion. This theory still seems to be widely accepted in physiotherapy schools, and we think it's time to change that. So let's look at some flaws of this concept, followed by an alternative proposal. Number one, location of cuff tears. If rotator cuff failure is caused by mechanical irritation by the undersurface of the acromion and coracoacromial ligament, then this should result in abrasion to the superior bursal side surface of the rotator cuff, especially in the supraspinatus. However, Payne et al. In the year 1988 reported that 91% of partial thickness tears in young athletes were found on the inferior articular side of the supraspinatus, with only 4% on the superior side. Other studies from Fukuda and Allman support this finding, with slightly lower percentages found on the inferior side than in the Payne study. So why do tendons usually show tears on the underside of the tendon? Chilcook reasons that compressive load of the rotator cuff tendons on the humeral head might be an important factor for the development of tendinopathy. 2. Form of the acromion. If the impingement theory was true, we would expect that people with a type 3 acromion, so a hooked acromion, experienced more shoulder problems due to impingement compared to people with other acromion types. However, Gill et al. In the year 2002 found no significant association between acromion morphology and rotator cuff pathology in patients who were over the age of 50 in their study of 523 patients who underwent arthroscopic or open surgery of the shoulder. Number 3, acromion resection surgery. If the acromion was a problem, then certainly resection of the acromion should lead to better results than placebo surgery or no treatment, right? The CSAW trial conducted in 32 different hospitals in the UK showed that subacromial decompression surgery had no additional value over a placebo arthroscopy and no surgical treatment. The authors reasoned that the small difference between the surgical groups and no surgical treatment might be the result of, for instance, a placebo effect or postoperative physiotherapy. A Cochrane review and a review with meta-analysis from the year 2019 from Kajalainen and Ledioja add to these results. So if you happen to be a patient watching this video, surgery is not recommended. Number 4, an alternative hypothesis. Overuse tendinopathies involving the lateral epicondyle, patella, adductor, and Achilles tendons may occur without impingement from external structures, such as adjacent bony surfaces, and this may also be the case for the rotator cuff. It is possible that the external irritation accentuates the tendon failure, but it is unlikely that it is the primary cause. Like mentioned earlier, the compressive load that a tendon has to undergo when it has to wrap around the bone it attaches to might play an important role. The guys from Running Reform have created a great video about this concept that you can watch by a click in the top right corner. At last, we should look further than only mechanical factors that are responsible for tendon pathology, as it is probably a combination of factors including relative overload, genetics, nutritional and lifestyle variables, and a rotator cuff tendon failure may be seen as a continuum of pathology. For this reason, authors have come up with a new, more appropriate term like subacromial pain syndrome or rotator cuff tendinopathy. Some hardliners of the pain science department even go as far as just calling it shoulder pain, as we are not sure we can blame the structures of the subacromial space in the shoulder for a patient's pain experience. All right, This concludes our video on the flaws of the shoulder impingement theory. If you like these kind of videos, don't miss out on our video about scapular dyskinesis myth busting. If you want to improve your assessment or clinical reasoning skills, check out our assessment ebook, mobile app, or our online course on orthopedic physiotherapy of the upper and lower extremities. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.